Well, it seems like every time I dig this thing out and turn it on, I find something else to fix. And this last time I had it out, I heard something in the front end. Sounded like a little bit of a knock. So I started poking around, and I think we've got a water pump that's starting to fail on us. So when I grabbed the fan and moved the assembly back and forth, you can see the whole water pump pulley is moving. At first I thought it was the fan clutch going bad, but it feels pretty good. And then once I saw that pulley moving, I figured the bearing out there is going bad. Now, water pumps are pretty easy to replace, and you can do the job with the radiator in place. But for ease of filming, I'm going to go ahead and probably just pull the radiator out so I can get some light in there and show you guys what's going on. Before we get started, let's take care of some housekeeping items. It's generally recommended that you flush the cooling system prior to installing the new water pump. I'm not going to do that in this video because I was into this cooling system not that long ago and the internals were pretty good. If you look in the radiator though and see a bunch of scale or floating particles or your coolant just looks nasty when you drain it, you should probably do a system flush. Like the sticker on the box my new pump came in basically says, a dirty system can trash a new pump pretty quick. If you're changing out the water pump, you might also want to replace the thermostat at the same time. Again, I'm not going to do the thermostat in this video because I know this system is in good shape and it hasn't had any overheating problems, so I'm just going to leave it in there. This would also be a good time to inspect and replace, if necessary, the upper and lower radiator hoses since you have to drain the cooling system anyway. One thing I always do when working on projects is to disconnect the negative terminal from the battery. You just never know what might happen working down in the engine bay, so better safe than sorry. Also, anytime I drain critical fluids, I leave a note on the steering wheel that doesn't come off until those fluids are replaced at the end of the job. You'd be surprised how you forget things after an all-night wrench-a-thon, and little notes like that can save you a lot of money. Now, I said earlier that I was going to take out the radiator so I could try and get the camera and some light in there, and that's exactly what I ended up doing. But I just wanted to stress that you can replace the water pump without removing the radiator, or even the radiator hoses for that matter. If your rig still has the fan shroud though, you'll probably need to pull that out. The fan shroud is usually attached to the engine side of the radiator and should be pretty easy to get out. This is a picture of an original steel shroud from a 1981 truck. The later shrouds were made out of plastic. If you're working on a 22RE, you'll need to remove the intake pipe to get some working room. Sorry for the crappy picture, this truck is currently sitting in a dark shed awaiting its turn in a Gambler 500, if I can get it running. If your truck has power steering, you'll need to remove the power steering belt. The first step is to loosen the 19mm nut on the front of the power steering tensioner pulley. This nut locks the shaft the pulley is mounted to in the bracket. It needs to be loose in order for the pulley to be moved by the adjusting bolt on the side of the mounting bracket. Once the 19mm nut is loose, take a 12mm socket on a ratchet and begin turning the bolt head on the end of the pulley bracket counterclockwise. The bolt you're loosening is threaded through the shaft the pulley is mounted on, which is keyed to the bracket. When you loosen the bolt, the pulley will move toward the power steering pump, taking tension off the belt. You may have to push on the pulley a little once you loosen the adjusting bolt to slide the pulley and mounting shaft in the bracket towards the power steering pump. Sometimes they stick. Once the pulley moves toward the pump enough, remove the belt over the fan and out of the truck. At this point, you could also take off the tensioner pulley and inspect the bearing. If the bearing is bad, you can usually find numbers on the bearing or just take measurements and order a new one from a bearing supplier. I've replaced this one in the past and it was a pretty easy job. I'll put a link down in the video details section to a good video on how to remove and replace that bearing. If you do remove the pulley, take note of the order and position of the parts and make sure you don't lose any of the small assembly parts, including the bushing, retainer clip, and formed washer. They're important and they're hard to replace if you lose them. I forgot to mention it earlier, but if possible, you want to wait on draining the coolant until after you get the fan clutch, belts, and fan pulley off. I'll explain why in a minute, but now that you have the power steering belt off, you need to remove the fan clutch, pulley, and fan belt. First, you should loosen the four 10mm nuts that are holding the fan clutch and fan pulley to the water pump. With the fan belt still on and under tension, it makes it easier to break those four nuts loose. If you can't reach all four of the 10mm nuts with your wrench, put the transmission in neutral, then take a 19mm socket on a big ratchet and turn the crankshaft pulley bolt clockwise as you face the engine to move the fan pulley around and gain access to the remaining nuts. Leave a couple nuts on loose just so the fan clutch doesn't fall off when you release the belt tension in the next step. The alternator acts as a tensioner for the fan belt. You need to loosen the upper alternator fixing bolt so you can pivot the alternator towards the engine. A ratchet, 12mm socket, and extension can usually get the job done. Once the upper fixing bolt is loose, you should be able to push the alternator towards the engine, which will release the tension on the belt and allow you to remove it from the engine. If you loosen the upper fixing bolt and the alternator still won't pivot towards the engine, you may need to also loosen the lower pivot bolt. Sometimes people crank that bolt down so much it can bind the alternator in the bracket and not let it pivot. There's a nut on the back of this bolt, so it'll be a two-wrench kind of maneuver if you have to loosen or tighten it. You may also have an AC unit and/or smog pumps belt to deal with. Obviously, I'm not dealing with either of those on this engine, but it would be the same principle as dealing with the power steering tensioner pulley, meaning there's usually a fixing bolt and a tensioner bolt that you'll need to work with to loosen and remove the belt. Once you've got the belts out of the way, remove the remaining 10mm nuts and take the fan clutch assembly and pulley out. Okay, now that we've got the fan and fan clutch off of there, I can try and show you what it was that I was hearing and feeling. So I clamped some vice grips on here now. Let's see if you can hear this. There's obviously some play in that bearing now up in there. So that was the noise I was hearing. It sounded a lot like a clacking loose belt, but I'm pretty sure it's this bearing has reached the end of its service life. Usually the problem you're going to see is a little bit of coolant dripping from somewhere. There's actually a little tiny weep hole underneath here on the casting, and I'll show you on the new water pump where that is, but when the internal seal starts to fail, coolant will bypass that seal, and then they give it a little escape route down under here to kind of give you an early indication that the seal's failing. If you let it go long enough, obviously the seal's going to keep failing, and you can actually, the coolant will wash the bearing and make the bearing dry. I haven't seen a whole lot of these fails where I can hear the bearing and feel the bearing getting play before the seal starts to go and drip. But the dripping is a much more common problem than what we're seeing right here. Now we're going to shift over to the workbench and talk about the new parts. When you get your new water pump, if possible, check it at the parts store counter and make sure it has the following things in the box. Obviously, there should be a new water pump in there, but you also want to see a new gasket, as well as four new studs for your fan clutch. This is why you always want to check the box at the parts counter so you don't get all the way back home and find out you're missing stuff. Okay, so now what we need to do is put these new studs into the four holes. And since there's no conceivable reason why we'll ever want to pull them out again, I like to use good old high temperature Permatex Loctite, and in this case their version of high temp is red. Red Loctite doesn't always mean strength, it's just a color by manufacturer, so always read the bottle first. So just a drop in there, smooth in a little bit, and go ahead and just thread that in by hand till it bottoms out. Then you want to get two nuts that go up on there, and what you do to put a stud in is you thread one nut, don't thread it down all the way, but thread it down till there's some exposed thread up top, then stick the other nut on there, and you're going to jam them together with two wrenches. You hold the bottom one and tighten the top one so they're jammed together. And then you take the top one and you can tighten the stud down into the hole. And you don't have to go crazy, just nice and snug. To break the nuts loose, put the wrenches back on and while holding the upper one, turn the lower one down slightly to free them. Once they break loose, They'll both come off like that, and your stud is installed. I think I went out and bought two of these nuts just to be able to do this kind of thing. They're kind of a small metric size. In a pinch, you can always use the nuts that came off of, off of the fan clutch, but they're a little taller than what would be optimal. So if you can get your hands on just a couple of regular old metric nuts that fit, it works perfect for installing those studs. So the Toyota fan clutch is a fully self-contained unit. It's controlled by this bimetal spring here, which expands and contracts as the engine heats up and cools down, helping the unit to spin up or not spin as fast, depending on how warm it gets. The fluid inside this thing is about the consistency of honey, so you should be able to spin it, but it shouldn't sit there and free spin. It should, you know, just feel like you're working in a jar of honey almost. But what you're looking for when you inspect these is you want to see if there's any fluid leakage coming out of the back here. That would indicate the seals are compromised and it's losing its fluid. If it's locked up, something's probably wrong, or if it's free spinning around, it's probably blown out also. But if you don't see any fluid leakage, then just clean her up real good. Check the fins for any cracks or missing pieces that might make it unbalanced, because an unbalanced fan would probably wear on that new bearing that's in the water pump you're putting in. Beyond that, you should be good to go to reuse these. I'll put a link in the video details to a YouTube video I found that explains how this type of fan clutch actually works. So one thing I would recommend doing before you even drain the coolant out of your existing rig, and definitely before you take off your old water pump, is take your new water pump, now that you've got the studs installed, fit your pulley over it and make sure everything there fits good, but then also take your fan clutch and fit your fan clutch on there and make sure that fits and goes down flush. So if for some reason you're doing your test fit and the fan clutch does not want to go down all the way, you need to stop and identify what the problem is. If it feels like it might be trying to go on but it's just really hard, don't get tempted to put it on a little ways and then use the nuts to push it on the rest of the way, effectively press fitting it onto the shaft. It should not be a press fit. If you do press it on there, it can become ridiculously hard to get the fan clutch off of the water pump, and if you can't get the fan clutch off, you can't get the pulley off, and if you can't get the pulley off, it's almost impossible to get to those mounting nuts that are underneath the pulley, and that would make doing front engine work a lot more difficult, and it's just miserable in general. So to recap, if it's a tight fit, something's wrong, identify the problem and fix it. Do not use the nuts to pull this fan down. It should just slide right on. If you haven't done it already, and assuming the engine is cooled off, you need to open the radiator cap and drain the coolant using the petcock or drain plug at the bottom of the radiator. Drain the coolant into an appropriate container and dispose of it properly. If you have a radiator that has this style of drain plug, make sure you don't lose the rubber O-ring that is in between the drain plug and the radiator bung. Before you start unbolting the old pump, take a can of your favorite cleaner and a wire brush and try to clean around the water pump. You don't want a bunch of junk to fall into the timing cover when you pull the old pump off. A good practice when removing nuts and bolts from any engine cover is to make an outline on a piece of cardboard for reference. It's not a big deal on the water pump because there's only two sizes of fastener, but it's a good habit to get into. If you ever remove the timing cover, bolt lengths and locations become very important. On the 22R water pump, there are three nuts that go on studs in the timing cover, five small 6mm bolts, and one longer 8mm bolt that actually goes through the water pump and timing cover into the block. Even when there's no chance you can screw up which bolt goes in which hole, it's still a good idea to do the template in case somebody in the past has boogered up a hole or stretched a bolt. If you find one that's a problem, you can address that hole and that bolt and not risk screwing up another hole by trying to run a bad bolt into it on reassembly. Once you have all the nuts and bolts removed, put a bucket under the front end of the engine and separate the old water pump from the timing cover. I was pretty happy with what I found behind the old pump. It looked pretty good under there for a nearly 40-year-old engine that's still running on the original bottom end.
So now that the old pump is off, we need to clean the sealing surfaces to prep for the new gasket and pump. I like to carefully jam some shop towels into the coolant ports of the timing cover before I start scraping off the old gasket material. We don't want that stuff falling in and getting circulated through the new pump. Basically, just do what you gotta do to get that sealing surface as clean as you can. I usually start with razor blades, being careful not to ding up the aluminum sealing surface too much. When the razor blade isn't getting it done, I usually put some chemical gasket remover on a rag and wipe it on and let it do its work and then scrape it some more. I also like to use a plastic abrasive cup brush to remove old gasket and sealer that wouldn't come off with scraping. If you do have access to air tools and the little abrasive discs or brushes, they work great, but be careful not to use an abrasive that's too aggressive. You don't want to create an uneven sealing surface. I'm a big believer in spending the time to properly prep sealing surfaces. A little extra time at this point in the job is worth it to ensure that you won't have to be back in here for a long time. One thing I'll do while I'm waiting for gasket remover to soak in is clean the hardware that I'll be reusing. I'll take each bolt and clamp it in the vise and run a wire brush over it. I'll also chase the threads with a die just to get everything as clean as possible. It also gives me a chance to inspect each bolt and decide if there are any that need to be replaced or if I see signs of a possible problem in the timing cover threads that might need to be addressed. I'll also use the double nut technique I used for installing the fan clutch mounting studs to make sure the three studs in the timing cover are tight. And finally, I'll chase the threads on the three studs to clean them up also. Once the old gasket has been cleared and the sealing surface on the timing cover looks good, I'll give it a final cleaning with acetone. I'll take the new water pump and check the sealing surface on it also. If there's any edges that have imperfections or dings, I'll just knock them down with a small flat file. I'll also clean the sealing surface on the new pump with acetone. I like those surfaces to be squeaky clean. Next, I'll check the gasket that was included to make sure it's going to line up with all the mounting bolt and stud holes. I'll then put the gasket down on a piece of cardboard with the side that mounts to the timing cover facing up. This is Permatex high-tack gasket sealant. I love this stuff. It's resistant to pretty much all automotive fluids, including gasoline, oil, tranny fluid, brake fluid, and coolant. The main reason I love this stuff is that since it doesn't fully harden, if you have to go back into the parts at a later date, you just separate them and clean up the surfaces with a rag and lacquer thinner. I usually paint the engine side of the gasket with high-tack. There's a little brush in the cap on the container. Let it tack up for a few minutes and then stick it to the engine and move it around so all the bolt holes are lined up. After sticking the gasket to the engine, I'll carefully paint the sealing surface of the new water pump. Once the water pump has a good coat of high tack on it, I'll stick the pump to the gasket and begin putting in the mounting bolts and nuts finger tight. Another huge benefit of using high tack is that, unlike RTV, there's almost no risk of blobs of it breaking off and plugging coolant passages or oil galleys. The downside to this stuff is that it's sticky and can be a bit of a pain to apply. You can't use high tack as a standalone gasket material like RTV. You have to apply it in conjunction with using a gasket, but it works great for holding a gasket in place and sealing little imperfections in the mounting surfaces. I'll put an Amazon link down in the video details section so you can check it out for yourself. I wasn't paid to promote this stuff in the video, I've just used it for a long time and it's always worked great for me. I go through the bolts and snug them up evenly to start. None of the factory service manuals I have actually list a specific torque spec for the small M6 by 1.0 water pump bolts and nuts. However, the larger 8mm bolt is actually a timing cover bolt that passes through the water pump, timing cover, and into the block. It has a listed spec of 13 Newton meters or 9 foot-pound. Because I'm a bit OCD about bolt torque, I went ahead and torqued all the 6mm hardware to 8 Newton meters, which is approximately 6 foot-pound. That's a bit on the conservative side, but I figured since the hardware is nearly 40 years old and since the bolts are going into blind aluminum holes, I wouldn't press my luck. I did do a couple of passes with the torque wrench to allow for gasket compression and sealer squeeze. After you get the bolts torqued down, be sure and spin the pump a bit to make sure the impeller isn't rubbing anything on the inside. It's unlikely, but you never know. If there's a clearance problem, tear it apart and figure out what's wrong. Letting the impeller self-clearance the timing cover would not be optimal. Well, now it's time to put it all back together and run it. First, put the fan pulley on the new water pump and then the fan clutch. Take the four flange head nuts and put them on the studs finger tight. After you get the four nuts on, take a 10mm wrench and tighten them all up. If you haven't done it already, inspect your belts for cracks, glazing, or missing chunks. If you see any of that stuff, you'll want to replace the belts. Next, work the fan belt around the fan and put it into the appropriate groove on the fan pulley, the crankshaft, and the alternator. Tension for the fan belt is applied by pivoting the alternator away from the engine. To put final tension on the belt, you can carefully stick a pry bar between the alternator and the block and lever it back. Make sure you don't pry against any wires or parts that could break. Once you get good belt tension, tighten the fixing bolt at the top of the alternator. Now with the belt holding the fan pulley, you can finish tightening the mounting nuts. If the engine tries to rotate on you even with the belt on, just hold the crankshaft pulley. If you can't reach all the nuts, put the tranny in neutral and rotate the engine clockwise as you face it with a 19mm socket and a large ratchet. There's actually a special tool for checking belt tension. Unfortunately, I don't own one of those tools to show you how it works, but an alternate method is to lay a straight edge across two pulleys and push down firmly on the belt in the center between them, and then measure the deflection or how far the belt can be pushed down. A good rule of thumb is that if the pulley center to center is less than 12 inches, deflection should be between 1/8 and 1/4 inch. If the pulley center to center is more than 12 inches, then deflection of 1/8 to 3/8 of an inch is fine. Personally, I like to run my belts towards the larger measure. If you run a belt too tight, you can prematurely wear the pulley bearings in the equipment that's being driven by the belt, like the water pump, alternator, and power steering. If you have a smog pump and/or air conditioning, you'll put that belt on next. Those accessories will have some kind of tensioning bolt or idler pulley assembly to adjust belt tension. Finally, if you have power steering, you'll put that belt on last. Once you get the belt around the fan, crankshaft, and power steering pulleys, fit it over the power steering tensioner pulley. Finger snug the center nut on the pulley and then tighten the adjusting bolt on the side of the bracket to draw the tensioner pulley up and apply tension to the belt. Once you have good tension, tighten the center nut on the pulley to lock it in place and check the tension again. If you have to make adjustments, remember to loosen the center nut so you can move the pulley. I went ahead and changed my upper and lower radiator hoses and clamps on this project. I also used the high-tack sealant on my hose fittings. It helps keep the corrosion down and aids in the sealing if you've got old pitted pipes. It makes it a little more difficult to remove the hoses down the road, but I'll trade that for no leaks or corrosion. The old hoses weren't bad, but they weren't great either. I usually just toss old hoses that are still usable in the trail box. I've handed out a few over the years to folks who've split a hose out in the middle of nowhere and weren't carrying a spare. It's easier than driving them back to town, and you gain instant hero status. Now that everything's buttoned up, we need to refill the system with coolant. You generally want a 50-50 mix of coolant and water. There's discussion ad nauseum on the internet about using distilled versus ionized versus softened versus tap water. I'm not going to wade too far into that swamp in this video, but my experience has been that if you have good clean drinking water, not hard mineral-filled water, and you mix it properly with coolant and you change it at proper intervals, your system will be fine. This truck has been run on a 50-50 tap water to coolant mix for at least the last 26 years, and the internals still look great. But we have really good water here, so take that for what it's worth. You can always buy pre-mixed coolant too, but you essentially end up spending a lot of money for water because you'll have to buy 2 gallons of pre-mix to fill the system. So basically, do your own research on the subject and use whatever you're comfortable with. One thing I do strongly recommend is making sure your head is properly grounded. Worn-out coolant can serve as an alternate path to ground, and if you have stray electrical current from your charging or electrical system running through your coolant, it can cause electrolysis corrosion in the water jackets of the aluminum head. To combat this corrosion, the 22R series engines had a ground strap from the back of the head to the firewall. Make sure you have one and that the connections are good. There should also be ground straps from the engine block to the frame and from the body to the frame. If you didn't do it already, open the heater core valve by moving the lever in the cab from cool to warm so the whole system will circulate. The full cooling system capacity on the 1979 through 92 20 and 22R series engines is around 9 quarts or 2.25 gallons. 1993 and later were 10.5 quarts or 2.6 gallons. When you just drain the radiator and pull the water pump, you don't end up draining all the coolant in the engine or the heater core, so refilling the system isn't going to take the full coolant capacity. There's actually another drain at the back of the engine block on the driver's side if you want to drain the coolant trapped in the lower block. Even if you use this drain, you still won't get the coolant trapped in the heater core though. I usually don't pull that plug and drain the block during basic maintenance, but just be aware that it's there.
So, I don't know how well you guys can see it, but I've got a back flush tee back there in one of the heater hoses, and I like to open that thing up, take the cap off of it, when I'm filling coolant back into the radiator, because that bleeds air out through there and allows the system to really fill, so I don't have to burp it as much when we're done. And sometimes I'll even just take a bit of this, and at the very end I'll top it off right to the T and then put the cap back on. And I don't usually have many problems with air pockets in the system that way.
So remember how I said that you wouldn't be putting in the full system capacity? This is a picture of how much mixed coolant I had left on my second gallon after refilling the system. It ended up taking a bit over a gallon and a half to fill the system after draining the radiator and removing the water pump. You'll probably need a bit of that leftover 50-50 mix to top off the system once you warm it up, but it's also a good idea to empty out your old coolant from the overflow bottle and fill it with the new stuff. You can either pull the reservoir and dump it, or you can siphon it out. A cheap jiggle siphon is just about perfect for this job. With the overflow bottle, I like to initially fill it about halfway between the low and the high lines. You can check it again and bring it to the full line after you get the system up to operating temps and purge the air. Alright, it's time to reattach the negative battery cable, remove the reminder note from the steering wheel, and fire up the truck.
Now, what I like to do is leave the radiator cap off while I'm warming it up until I start seeing warm coolant circulating from the upper radiator hose into the radiator. And once I see that, then I'll put the radiator cap back in, go for a test drive, and then come back and burp the system. So it's warm, it's almost ready to start flowing, so we'll go take it for a test drive. We're just out here getting her all warmed up. We'll get up to the top of the hill here, and I don't know if you can see it, but this right here is about as hot as it usually gets just in regular driving. This thing's always run a bit on the cool side, which is fine, because when you're rock crawling and stuff, you don't have hardly any airflow moving over the radiator, so I'm okay with that. I might have put a cooler thermostat in there back in the day or something. Anyway, we'll rally it back to the house and call it a day. Okay, now that we're home and got everything shut off, it's still plenty hot. Feel good pressure in the upper radiator hose. And we're gonna burp the cap here. Yep, I heard it go through. So, release the pressure. We're gonna take a look at the level. Level looks really good. I might just add a little bit, but barely anything. So other than that, I think we're done.
Hey, thanks for watching my video. If you liked what you saw and found it helpful, please give it a like vote, share it on social media or special interest forums, and subscribe to my channel. If you want to be notified when I post a video, be sure to click the bell icon. Check out the video details for technical information, Amazon product links, and any updates or clarifications. Until next time, keep playing with your old toys.